This is the story of Fairhaven Farm.
What is Fairhaven Farm? Well, it's a place to where we gather, nourish, and inspire.
We just always wanted to have a place where people could gather and feel like they're coming to our farm, but it's also like a place that they feel at home.
So that's our philosophy. What we do is we grow organic vegetables for our CSA. That's our primary market for the vegetables. We sell bedding plants in the springtime out of our greenhouse. And we are starting a pizza farm. So we've built a big wood-fired oven on site here and invite folks out and sell pizzas with our fresh vegetables and Minnesota-grown flour. We like to be an open farm and get folks out and show people what we're all about and show people where their food comes from and show people how cool a farm can be.
John and Emily Beaton, owners of Fairhaven Farm, kindly allowed us to tour the farm and uncover its wonders. John and Emily developed Fairhaven Farm with the following core values. First, they acknowledge that everything is interconnected. People, plants, animals, the earth, everything. Second, they know that if we support the earth, including the soil, plants, and all living things, the earth will support us. Third, our health and happiness depend on what we consume and what we don't consume. Fourth, food should not be mere sustenance. It should be nourishing and beautiful. Fifth, food should taste good. Furthermore, food should be cooked with butter and love, and it should be enjoyed slowly with friends and family. And sixth, flowers are always a good idea. John and Emily told us the story behind the name of Fairhaven Farm. John's grandparents had a cabin in Detroit Lakes they called Fairhaven Resort. This had been a space that John and his family visited in the summer many times during his childhood and still cherish to this day.
It's a way to kind of honor my grandpa, and because that to me was a beautiful space of gathering, and I hope to kind of carry that spirit into our farm too.
Farms are often shaped by the folks who tend and love the land. In a similar way, a person's history and background are the things that shape a person. The two most important people at Fairhaven Farm are John and Emily. Our goal was to discover what types of life perspectives molded their beliefs and led them to be interested in and dedicated to sustainable farming, especially in northern Minnesota.
What helped shape those guiding values?
I just think time and being on the land and figuring out what the history of the land is. So like the previous landowner, I think she had similar goals and ambitions, and just looking at our land and seeing how it's, what it's suited for. You know, it's not really suited for planting fence row to fence row and maximizing production that way. So it's just really suited to having people come out and having people experience it. So I think time and being here and
it's also suited to our personality and kind of what we were drawn to and what made us want to become farmers. Like, we both had interest in like gathering with other people and making food, making big meals and sharing food together, and that's kind of what inspired me to want to be a farmer, and you too.
Oh, for sure.
Being able to share that with other people. We just always wanted to have a place where people could gather and feel like they're coming to our farm, but it's also like a place that they feel at home.
Farming can often be portrayed as a predominantly male profession. Emily explained to us what it means to her to be a female farmer.
I would say that, you know, there's some challenges that go along with that. But mostly I've been, you know, supported along the way. I think that the time is here for, you know, women to be part of farming. And I actually probably know more young women farmers than male farmers. It just so happens that one of my farm mentors was a really strong woman as well. And so that has kind of helped inspire me and move me along.
When asking John about his own background and what sparked his interest in farming, he mentions his influence from Professor David Searing.
He challenged our class with a project. And so we were divided into groups. And each group had to prepare a dish. And the one with the least amount of food miles attached to that dish won. And so, you know, everybody tried it out. And a couple people, you know, they just went to the grocery store and they tried to find kind of some local stuff. And but I dug a little deeper. I found the food farm. And so I went down to Carlton and went right to the source. And they have a great big root cellar there, huge root cellar there. And I went there and I bought all of our ingredients right out of the root cellar from John Fisher Merritt, kind of the godfather there of vegetable growing in our region. And basically we won the competition, but also I met John Fisher Merritt and through him got connected to my farm mentor, Rick Dalen, at Northern Harvest Farm. And so really, I mean, my college experience, I think kind of morally and intellectually aligned my vision for the future towards farming, and then it actually like put me on a farm. So yeah, it's great.
One way John and Emily create a stronger sense of community on the farm is through a fun-filled night of homemade pizza with farm-fresh ingredients, sourced from local providers as well as from Fairhaven Farm themselves. The pizza is baked in a large outdoor oven adorned with Buddhist prayer flags. Members of the community are invited to come share a slice and learn about Fairhaven Farm. This encourages participation in sustainable farming and could potentially pique interest from the younger generations of future farmers. The pizza nights will take place from June to September on the first Friday of each month.
So this season we tried out the pizza night concept. It was just more of a, you know, kind of practice to mm-hmm. see if it was something that would be popular and profitable, yep. And whether or not we could pull it off. And we found out that it was pretty well received. We didn't do a whole lot of marketing, but we still had pretty steady turnouts, and so we're excited about what that could look like if we actually do open it up to the public and then market it. And we've been to other pizza nights, other farms that offer pizza nights, and it just seems like a really fun way to gather the community and get them out to a farm so they can see what a farm is like.
Mm-hmm. So we built the oven to create bread and pizza. And so there are two different processes. So the bread will create a fire in the chamber, and it takes about, depending on how hot the oven is when you start, about 3 to 4 hours to warm the thing up. And then once it's at temperature, you scrape all the fire out, and then you have about a 2-hour window where you can bake bread. And so it's just a matter of timing. We get all the bread prepared, shaped, so that the bread itself proofs for about an hour before it goes into the oven, so you just got to get all the timing right. And me and you go out there and throw it in the oven as fast as we can, close the door, and about a half hour later we can pull about 25 loaves of bread out of the oven. Mm-hmm.
All in all, the bread is probably like a 12-hour process.
At least. Sometimes we'll mix the dough together the night before and let it ferment overnight. And so yeah, it's a lengthy process, but it really produces kind of the ultimate bread in my mind. So, and then the pizza is a different deal. So the pizza will warm the oven up for still about 3 to 4 hours, but we'll maintain a live fire in there. So then now the chamber is going to be probably between 700 and 900 degrees with that fire in there. And we can just slide pizzas in and out. It takes about 2 minutes to make a pizza.
John and Emily are very dedicated to community engagement. They showcase this by taking a step further and including their produce and other goodies in a CSA.
So a CSA stands for Community Supported Agriculture. And it was a model that was developed in Japan. And it allows a way for the farmer to get some money up front from their members who subscribe or join the farm in the springtime or in the early January, February months. Mm-hmm. And so they would then, you know, pay a fee for the membership, and that allows the farmer to then plan for the whole season, be able to order their seeds, order materials and tools, and then plan that season. And then in turn, that customer or that member would get a box of vegetables every week throughout the growing season. And it's a way for, I don't know, the community to feel more involved in that farm. It brings a sense of ownership for them. And then it helps the farmer have some stability as well.
Emily and John have plans for more community involvement in the future.
We would like to be able to host other community events, gather, you know, community groups. Like we had a yoga instruction school come out and have a picnic here and give them a farm tour. We like to do things like that where we're working with other community-focused groups.
Workshops,
classes.
Workshops. Yeah.
We're just really kind of tapping. We're barely scratching the surface of like what we could do here. Mm-hmm. And I think as we build more infrastructure, we'll be able to host more events.
This year, I've started to kind of become more politically active in the different organizations I'm involved with, the National Young Farmers Coalition and the Minnesota Farmers Union. And so I think in the future, too, both political and organizing centered around farming issues, and trying to actually get lawmakers out to the farm to show them the future of farming, you know. So I think that's going to be a big part of what we do too.
We also have a stage in our barn, so we plan to host live music events, music jams,
mm-hmm.
maybe a concert series or something like that.
We all experienced an eye-opening journey while visiting Fairhaven Farm and discovering all that it has to offer. During our visit, we saw firsthand the hard work and dedication it takes to create something meaningful and worthwhile.
I feel like farming is kind of an artistic expression in and of itself. You know, it's kind of the ultimate thing that you could actually create, you know, to plant a seed and then see it come to life. So, yeah, and I think that, you know, just having that background of, like, growing up out in the country, in the nature, also kind of is, like, a deep part of me. So that's made me want to become a farmer, too, just be connected with that again. I didn't want to see myself sitting behind a desk and working at a computer for the rest of my life. So this allows me to still have, you know, some design and visual stuff that I'm working on in the farm, but then also just be like surrounded by nature as well.
My only advice is just never give up. I mean, you got that vision. It's the perfect time to become a farmer right now, because there's government programs, nonprofit programs, resources, loans. I mean, there's so many different things out there for a young farmer now that, yeah, I think the time is kind of ripe, and people are becoming more conscious of where their food is coming from. And so you got to define that vision and just never give up. It's super, super hard, but I hope that we can be an example of this is what you can achieve, you know? And we're happiest we've ever been, you know? We love it out here.